فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
This, brothers, is it's the fourth day in our dawra, which we named it ضبط العلم, precision in knowledge. We've finished three books, or two books. Inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to finish the third book, بإذن الله الكريم. We always start with the book شرح تعظيم العلم, glorifying knowledge, written by Shaykh Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Muhammad al-Usaymi حفظه الله تعالى.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. المقعد الرابع, صرف الهمة فيه إلى علم القرآن والسنة. إن كل علم نافع مرده إلى كلام الله وكلام رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم, وباقي العلوم إما خادم لهما فيؤخذ منهما تتحقق به الخدمة, أو أجنبي عنهما فلا يضر الجهل به.
The author رحمه الله, this fourth chapter, he called it صرف الهمة, to divert your aspiration in knowledge towards the knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah. What you should make your ultimate goal, the thing that you are striving to, the thing that you want to attain, is علم القرآن والسنة. That's the thing that you strive for. And this is what this chapter is about, that a person should make their aspiration, their drive, their intention, or even their purpose in what? علم القرآن والسنة. That you want to learn the Quran and the Sunnah. That's your goal. That's why you study the religion. And the author, it would have been better if he added onto that, والفقه المستنبط منهما, and the fiqh that is derived from both of them. Because fiqh is categorized into two, fiqh akbar and fiqh asghar, the major fiqh and the minor fiqh. The major fiqh is aqeedah, and aqeedah is a maqsad min maqasid al-ilm, it's one of the objectives of knowledge. And the second one is fiqh al-asghar, which is the one that make commonly known as fiqh. Fiqh al-amaliyat, al-tahara, al-salah, al-siyam, al-sawm, al-hajj, etc. So, wal-fiqh al-mustanbati minhuma, the fiqh that is derived from the Quran and the Sunnah, is a goal as well that a person should strive to. Then the author says, after his chaptering, إن كل علم نافع مرده إلى كلام الله وكلام رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Every beneficial knowledge مرده إلى كلام الله, it goes back to the speech of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Every beneficial knowledge there is, it goes back to Allah سبحانه وتعالى's speech. وكلام رسوله, and the speech of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَبَاقِ الْعُلُومِ إِمَّا خَادِمٌ لَهُمَا, and the remaining other sciences, they serve the Qur'an and the Sunnah. So علم المصطلح, which is نخبة الفكر, what we studied, and الورقات, that we're hopefully going to study inshallah ta'ala, and قواعد الفقهية, and النحو, and بلاغة, and صرف, أدب, the Arabic literature. All of these are sciences, and what they do is خَادِمٌ لَهُمَا, they serve the Qur'an and the Sunnah. وَلِذَلِكَ, as I mentioned yesterday, الْإِمَامُ الشَّافِعِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ, he memorized so many poetries. الْإِمَامُ الشَّافِعِيُّ, he memorized a lot of poetry. And he was asked, why is he memorizing all of these poetries? And what is his purpose behind this? And Imam Shafi'i said, لِأَخْدُمَ الْفِقْهَ, so I can serve fiqh. The reason why I'm learning poetry is so that he can strengthen his Arabic language and it becomes strong for him then to understand fiqh. Whether that fiqh is fiqh al-akbar, aqidah, or if that fiqh is fiqh al-asghar, the minor fiqh. Whatever it may be, it all requires what? It all requires a person who is solid in the Arabic language. It really needs you to be grounded in the Arabic language. ولذلك الأصمعي عبد الملك ابن قريب الأصمعي when he met الإمام الشافعي he said that عبد الملك ابن قريب الأصمعي he said when I met شافعي and شافعي was at the age of 16 he said I took from him the أشعار of هذيل the poetry of the people of هذيل I took it down from him he is the one who taught me it and he himself عبد الملك الأصمعي He himself was a imam in the Arabic language. He was a imam in the Arabic language. But Shafi'i did all of that to learn the Arabic language, to master the language, to give time out to the language, as he mentioned, لأخدم الفقه, so I can serve fiqh. So this falls under the ulum, which the author here mentions, the ulum which is khadimah. They serve the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Usul al-fiqh is the same. The person studies dalalat al-alfad, and we will be speaking more about that when we study usul kitab al-waraqat. When we study al-waraqat, we'll explain more what usul al-fiqh is about. But it's a science, without it, a person will truly not be able to extract rulings from the Qur'an or the Sunnah. You won't be able to. And then comes in mustalah al-hadith, which is a science that allows you to what? Know what is authentic and what is not authentic. Because you can't base a ruling on something that is, on something that's weak. So these sciences, the author calls it, the sciences which serve fiqh, or serve the Qur'an and the Sunnah. In simple terms, some other scholars, they call it ulumu al-wasail. The instrumental knowledge. It's an instrument. An instrument is what you use to open doors with. If you want to open things, you use an instrument. You want to break down something, you use an instrument. Usul al-fiqh, al-mustalah, al-hadith, al-nahu, al-tajweed, and others are all wasail, means. They are all instrumental knowledge. And there is the second one is called ulum al-maqasid, which is the objective. It's the ultimate. It's the Qur'an and Sunnah. Sometimes what happens is, you meet a person for 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. He's learning qira'at, or he's even learning nahu, balagha, and he does not know any fiqh ruling. He doesn't know the Qur'an, it's tafsir. He knows qira'at. He doesn't know the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And this is a khalal, a deficiency, which is that you preoccupied yourself with something that was a means, and you left off something that was the maqsad, the goal. You were learning the Arabic language in order to understand the Qur'an and the sunnah. But the aim was not for you to spend the rest of your life in the Arabic language. ولذلك ابن رجب رحمه الله in his kitab فضل علم السلف على علم الخلف he mentions that the Arabic language is like salt. It's like milh. It's like what? Salt. Anybody who doesn't have salt in their food, it doesn't taste nice, does it? However, if too much is added to it, there's always that moderation that's needed, right? Nahwa is like that. If you don't have it at all, you're deficient. And if you overdo it, it becomes what? It also becomes a deficiency, a problem. You have to know enough to understand the Qur'an and the Sunnah. That is the ultimate goal. فَيُؤْخَذَ فيؤخذ منه ما تتحقق به الخدمة. The other sciences, what you take from it is whatever will allow you to understand and fulfill the need of the Quran and the Sunnah. The Arabic language, what you need from it is an amount. That amount you need from the Arabic language, or the ulumul that are known as ulumul wasail, the instrumental knowledge, is what can allow you to understand the Quran and the Sunnah. The amount is, that's what you need to take. As I said, going overboard with it, it's going to cause you problems. أو أجنبي عنهما فلا يضر الجهل به. The second science is, so the Sheikh divided the sciences after the Quran and the Sunnah, he divided them into two. The first one was what? علوم, sciences, الخادمة لكلام الله وكلام رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Sciences that serve the Quran and the Sunnah. And it's what we call علوم الآلات, علوم الوسائل, means. And it is what helps what? ما يعين على فهمهما. Anything that would, it would help you in understanding the Quran and the Sunnah. That's the first one. It's the one we spoke about now. The second one is علوم أجنبية, foreign sciences. It is sciences which is foreign. And what it means by that is that it doesn't serve the Quran nor the Sunnah. It's like learning engineering or learning medicine or also learning any other sciences. The Sheikh says, فَلَا يَضُرُّ الْجَهْلُ بِهِ. Being ignorant of it will not harm you. فَلَا يَضُرُّ, it's being ignorant of engineering will not harm you. In the sense where it won't harm your Quran or your Sunnah. نعم.
فَإِلَى الْقُرْآنِ وَالسُّنَّةِ يَرْجِعُ الْعِلْمُ كُلُّهُ وَبِهِمَا أُمِرَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ كَمَا قَالَ تَعَالَى فاستمسك بالذي أوحي إليك إنك على صراط مستقيم.
The author رحمه الله, he said, فإلى القرآن والسنة يرجع العلم كله. All of knowledges, they go back to the Quran and the Sunnah. فإلى القرآن والسنة يرجع العلم كله. All of knowledges go back to the Quran and the Sunnah. وَبِهِمَا, and with them, with the two of them, أُمِرَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And these two is what the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was commanded. كَمَا قَالَ تَعَالَى, as Allah said in the Quran, فَاسْتَمْسِكْ. In the Arabic language, they use the word تَمَسَّكْ. And this is the one that Ibn Abi Dawood used in his Ha'iyya, which is a book in Aqidah. He said, تمسك بحبل الله واتبع الهدى ولا تك بدعيا لعلك تفلح ودن بكتاب الله والسنن التي أتت عن رسول الله تنجو وتربح. He said, تمسك, hold on to. But this ayah doesn't say تمسك. It says istamsik, and the qa'idah, the principle for the scholars of grammar is every time the structure becomes more, then the meaning also becomes more ghaliban. So the qa'idah is ziyadatul mabna ziyadatun fil ma'na ghaliban. Tamassak is how many letters? It's ta, mim, sin, and kaf, four letters. Istamsik, on the other hand, is what? Extra two, six altogether. So because it has six letters, it has more meaning. That's the majority of the times, not always the case. That's why we said ghaliban. Like for example, the word seen and sofa. Seen, what does it show? The word seen, if it goes before a present verb, if it goes before a fi'l mudari', what does it show? Future, right? Are you with me, brothers? Seen, when it goes before fi'l mudari', a present verb, سيفعلون. It was يفعلون, right? You put a seen before it, and it became سيفعلون. What does it now show? Future, right? What about if you put before it sofa? Sofa يفعلون. It also shows future. But what's the difference? Based on this principle, because sofa has more letters, and it's three letters, seen, wow, and fa. And سيفعلون is only one letter extra, which is the seen. It's only seen. Then the sofa shows more of a future than seen. That's what the qa'ida is. زيادة المبنى زيادة في المعنى غالبا. So the Prophet ﷺ here is being told to him, استمسك, hold onto it even more. So it's not just hold on. Are you with me? استمسك means hold onto it even more. بالذي أوحي إليك, the revelation that has been sent on you. And the revelation that has been sent on the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, as Al-Imam Al-Hafidh Al-Hakami رحمه الله says, فَسُنَّةُ النَّبِيِّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ عَلَيْهِمَا قَدْ أُطْلِقَ الْوَحْيَانِ وَإِنَّمَا طَرِيقُهَا الرِّوَايَةِ فَافْتَقَرَ الرَّاوِي إِلَى الدِّرَايَةِ. The sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is it's another form of revelation. Na'am. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says about the messenger, when najmi idha hawa, ma dhalla sahibukum wa ma ghawa, wa ma yantiqu anil hawa, in huwa illa wahyu yuha. Everything that the messenger says is a what? It's a revelation. Min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So first time seek, hold on to the Qur'an, which is a revelation, and also the Sunnah, which is another revelation that Allah sends on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِنَّكَ يُو مُحَمَّدٍ are upon عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. You are upon the straight path. It doesn't matter what these people say to you, that you are misguided and that you are a crazy person, a fortune teller. Because that's what they told the Prophet, that's what they said to him. They said to him, you're leaving the path of your forefathers. You're coming with something new, strange. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah said to him, إِنَّكَ عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. You are upon the straight path.
وَهَلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَىٰ بِالْقَاسِمِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ شَيْءٌ سِوَى الْقُرْآنِ وَالسُّنَّةِ.
The Prophet, the Shaykh then says now, is what I mentioned already. وَهَلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَىٰ أَبِي الْقَاسِمِ. Was there anything else sent to the Prophet as a revelation? سوى القرآن والسنة, other than the Quran and the Sunnah. وهل أوحي, was anything as sent down to him as a revelation other than the Quran and the Sunnah? So what he means, فاستمسك بالذي أوحي إليك. He's trying to explain to you that hold on to the revelation we sent on you. The Shaykh is asking you a question now. And this istifham is called istifham inkari, meaning the answer is already known to me. Is rejecting this answer, which is Allah did not send on the Prophet anything as a revelation other than the Quran and Sunnah. So within the question, there's a negation. It's called istifhamun urida bihi al-inkaru. Ama istifhamun inkariyun. Ama istifhamun urida bihi nafyun. All of them are in there. Is that when the person asks a question, but their question is already a negation. When your parents say to you, are you going to go with your friends? You know already means you're not going to go with your friends. It's a question, the way they asked you it. But you know you have to just give one answer, say, no mom, why did you think so? I'm not going to go with my friends. Sah. The Shaykh here says, وَهَلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَىٰ أَبِي الْقَاسِمِ. أَبِي الْقَاسِمِ is a kunya in the Arabic language. And a kunya is a name given to a person after a child that they had. And sometimes no. ولذلك عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها, she came to the Prophet, she said, Ya Rasulullah, everyone has a kunya, I don't have no kunya. Then the Messenger said to her, صلى الله عليه وسلم, take a kunya from your own nephew, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, who her sister gave birth to. The Prophet said, take it from him. So Aisha radiallahu anha was called what? Umm Abdullah, the mother of Abdullah. She never even had him. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to even give kunya to children who weren't even married. Children. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the young boy, he said, Ya Aba Umayr, ma fa'ala al-Nughayr. It was a young boy who lost his bird. So the Prophet said to him, Ya Aba Umayr, Aba Umayr, ma fa'ala al-Nughayr. What did Nughayr do? And it was not min al-Muda'aba. The Prophet was playing with him, alayhi salatu wasalam. But he gave him a kunya. Now that's something the Arab culture is common. Within our culture, on the other hand, Somalian community is not. The kunya is not so very common. Because they take it very personal. They're trying to say, you have to get to know me through my son who just came yesterday. I was here all this time. Yeah, you have to get familiar with me through my son. So, because the father of the child that you just had. So you become famous on that child's name. Now.
ومن جعل علمه القرآن والسنة كان متبعا غير مبتدع ونال من العلم أوفرا.
The Sheikh gives the قاعدة now. It's a principle. Memorize it. There's some things in here that he says that our قواعد and principles. You should memorize them. He said, ومن جعل علمه القرآن والسنة. Anyone who makes his knowledge, the Quran and the Sunnah, that's what he makes his knowledge. كان متبعا. This person is a follower. He's an adherer. غير مبتدع, he's not an innovator. ونال من العلم أوفرة. And that person will attain and will gain a high portion of knowledge. He will attain a great amount of knowledge. نعم.
قال ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه من أراد العلم فليثور القرآن فإن فيه علم الأولين والآخرين.
Then the author brings the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud رضي الله تعالى عنه. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is a person who was known for his knowledge, his comprehension of the religion, and how powerful he was in the Quran. In the recitation and the understanding of the Quran, both. As for the recitation, the Prophet ﷺ heard his recitation, and he said, "Man arad an yaqra al-Qur'an ghaddan dariyan kama unzil." The Prophet ﷺ, he said, "Anybody who wants to read the Quran fresh, as it just came down, not tampered with, fresh, pure, in its correct manner, فليقرأ بقراءة ابن أم عبد." Let him read in the recitation of who? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. His qira'ah was, it was pure. In the sense where it wasn't tampered with. That's in terms of his Qur'anic recitation. And his pronunciation and his articulation of the wordings. As for his understanding of the Qur'an, he was, as he said, مَا مِنْ آيَةٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا وَأَنَا أَعْلَمُ أَيْنَ نَزَلَتْ. There is not an ayah in the Qur'an except I know where it came down on and who it came down on and when it came down. I know all of that pertaining to it. And if I was to know anyone more knowledgeable than me in the Qur'an, in which my riding beast can go to and that it could reach them, I would go to them and try to take it from them. But Ibn Mas'ud knew that at his time there was no one who understood the Qur'an the way he did. There was a time he realized that no one knew the Qur'an and understood the Qur'an the way he did. So he wasn't from those people who just memorized the Quran. They knew, as Hassan al-Basri said, that there are going to come a people that are going to recite the Quran, يُقِيمُونَ حُرُوفَ. They're going to articulate and read the wordings correctly. Each makhraj would be right. Each letter would come out from the right place. They will be reading the Quran as it came down. يُقِيمُونَ حُرُوفَ. They will establish its wordings correctly. وَيُضَيِّعُونَ حُدُودَهُ. But then they forsake its boundaries. And the way that a person will forsake the boundaries of the Quran is when they don't understand what is in it. And a lot of the sad things today with a lot of the people who've given time to the Quran, who are masters in the recitation of the Quran, you find a lot of them, they go against the sunnah of the messenger by cutting their beards, getting rid of it in totality. When you listen to his recitation of the Quran, your mouth drops. How he says every letter, and you can hear every letter come out from his mouth correctly. But he's what? He's halikul lihya. His beard is gone, he's got no beard. Musbirul izar, his garment is dragging on the ground. He might even be smoking. If you go to Egypt, the teachers who teach in Azhar, who teach fiqh, who teach qira'at and the Quran, they smoke. At break time they go out, he comes back in. And he carries on from where he was. Yeah. So this is what Hassan al-Basri already told us about. The Quran is not mujarrad al-alfaz. It's not just mere letters, it is the combining of two. وَلِذَلِكَ السَّلَفُ هَذِي الْأُمَّةِ. When they called a person a qari, I'm a qurra. The qurra were not only reciters. No, not at all. Inshallah ta'ala, it will be good to study the life of Al-Imam Abu al-Qasim al-Shatibi, rahimahullah. Abu al-Qasim al-Shatibi, the author of the kitab حرز الأماني ووجه التهاني, which is known as منظومة الشاطبية. Scholars differed on his kunya, whether it's Abu al-Qasim, Abu Muhammad, khilaf, right? He wasn't just an imam in qira'at. No, not at all. Wala Imam al-Jazari was not an imam only in qira'at. لذلك ابن الإمام الذهبي هذا كتاب called معرفة قراء الكبار. الإمام الذهبي هذا book called معرفة قراء الكبار. And he talks about the biography of the great illustrious scholars of قراءات. He talks about their lives. Read them. Ibn Malik, the Imam of the Arabic language, was not just an Imam in the language. He used to come out every day in the morning. He used to come out, Al-Imam Ibn Malik. And he would say to the people, who wants me to explain Sahih al-Bukhari for them? And Imam Ibn Malik, the great grammarian. This ideology, which is ana mutakhassis in this field, and I'm jahil of all the other fields of the Sharia, this is something that has been taken and adopted from the Western world. They're the ones who, the guy knows this, he doesn't know anything else about any other sciences. In the Sharia, na'am, there is a field Allah opens for you. And you become a master in that field. But that doesn't mean you're jahil of the other fields. Na'am, Abu al-Qasim al-Shatibi rahimahullah, he's an imam in qira'at, an imam in this field. But that doesn't mean he was jahil of all the other sciences. And Imam al-Jazari, by the way, you know, he has a book of poetry in ilm al-hadith, mustalah al-hadith. Al-Imam al-Jazari rahimahullah, the author and the scholar of Tajweed. And he's not a, لذلك the قراء and the أئمة القراءات are not just all قراء. Al-Imam al-Jazari was not just a qari, or he knew قراءات. He was a محقق of قراءات. He could do تحقيقات of a mas'ala in qira'ah, and he would have a wajh in it. His statement would be given consideration. Others may just be qurra, they recite the different qira'at, but they're not muhaqqiqin necessarily. Their statements don't have no weight. He's just a muqallid, he recites with different qira'at faqat. And Imam al-Jazari reached a level where he could do tahqiq of a mas'ala in qira'at, and it will be something that will be taken on board and considered. That it's a wajh min al-wujuh, a way, and it will be observed. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud jama'a bayna al-qira'ati, he combined between the recitation of the Qur'an, and he also combined, and he also took on board the understanding of what the Qur'an was about. He said, man arad al-ilma, anyone who wants knowledge, anyone who wants to understand this religion, فَلْيُثَوِّرِ الْقُرْآنَ مَا مَعْنَى فَلْيُثَوِّرِ The word فَلْيُثَوِّرِ is to research. بحث. That's what it is. يُثَوِّرِ مَا مَعْنَاهُ الْبَحْثُ is to research and look for الْقُرْآنَ فَإِنَّ فِيهِ عِلْمَ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخِرِينَ Because in the Qur'an is the knowledge of the early people and those to come. The Qur'an has the knowledge of both. So that's why a person who learns the Qur'an and the meaning in the Qur'an and digests the information of the Qur'an is sitting with powerful knowledge. He's got with him the knowledge of those who came and the knowledge of those to come. Naam.
وقال مسروق ما نسأل أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم عن شيء إلا علمه في القرآن إلا أن علمنا يقصر عنه.
مسروق, his name is called مسروق ابن الأجدع الوادعي. He's from the tribe of Sheikh Muqbil ibn Hadi al-Wadi'i. Sheikh Muqbil's tribe is not, some people think it's just a tribe, small tribe that Wadi' are a very, very well-known tribe. Masruq ibn al-Ajda' is a tabi'i. He met companions. He met Umar radiallahu anhu. He wasn't just a tabi'i. He was a mukhdarm. He was a mukhadram. He was a mukhadram, which means he lived at the time of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never met him. Like Najashi. Rather, he took Islam whilst the Prophet was alive. Like Najashi. But he never saw the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He took knowledge from Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and Amir al-Sha'bi took knowledge from him. Masruq was the teacher of Amir al-Sha'bi and Ibrahim al-Nakha'i and others. He died when the Islamic calendar was 62. So he's from the kibar of the tabi'een. His kunya was Abu Aisha. Masruq says, ما نسأل, we don't ask أصحاب محمد, the Prophet's companions. We don't ask the companions of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم عن شيء أي matter إلا علمه في القرآن, except that knowledge is found in the Quran. We never ask the companions about a knowledge except when we look at it, we find that the knowledge is actually in the Quran. It was there. إلا أن علمنا يقصر عنه, except our knowledge has become short from the Quran. The Sahabas, whenever they were asked a question, they would derive it from where? Where would they take it from? The Quran. And the Tabi'i would think, Allah, it was there all along. It was right there in the Quran. And that's all they gave the answers based on. الإمام الشافعي in كتاب الرسالة he took it a step further. He said ما حكم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بشيء, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم didn't judge a matter. And he never passed a judgment عليه الصلاة والسلام except he what? He took it from the Quran. All the أحكام and the rules that the Prophet gave. الإمام الشافعي he said it is what the Prophet understood from the Quran. And because of the previous ayah is example for him, that's what Imam Shafi'i is using, which is اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء. Follow Muhammad, that which has been sent on you from your Lord. And do not follow any ally besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am.
وينسب لابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أنه كان ينشد جميع العلم في القرآن لكن تقاصر عنه الأفهام الرجال.
The author then says, وينشد لابن عباس. It was ascribed and it is attributed to ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما. May Allah be pleased with him and his father. أنه كان, that ابن عباس was one who used to ينشد. He would recite, read. The word yunshidu is where the word nasheed comes from. Yunshidu is to recite something, to read something. Ibn Abbas is, as you all know, ghaniyun ani ta'rif. He's too rich for us to even try to define who he is. Everyone here should know who Ibn Abbas is, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. But Ibn Abbas is from the seven. Ibn Abbas is from the seven who are considered and are called al-mukthirina fi riwayah, those who are excessive in narrating hadith. Walidhalika, it's all combined in one line of poetry.